In cold and tropical climes all over the world, hundreds of aquatic animals and plants, a wealth of genetic diversity, are now farmed under a variety of systems. From the small subsistence plot to the large industrial operation, providing food, health, and wealth, fueling economic growth, and sustaining livelihoods of small farmers. Turning points in aquaculture development. Communities prosper. People are stronger and healthier. More opportunity to improve livelihoods, more income, and better nutrition. Farmers and women are empowered. Integrated into traditional farming, aquaculture gave the people of this remote village in Vietnam an opportunity out of poverty and food insecurity. The inspiration and hard work was provided by this lady, who had been awarded by the United Nations for her work in rural development and women empowerment through fish farming. In 1993, ethnic minorities received more attention from the government's hunger and eradication policy. Fish farming was among the activities promoted. I sold my livestock to raise money to start a fish pond. We had little idea about fish farming, but the women's union helped us start. The earnings from fish farming enabled us to build a brick house, pay our debts, and pay for the children's education. Practiced and promoted by a man named Fan Li more than 2,000 years ago in what is now modern China, the first recorded system of fish culture, the raising of three or four species of carps in an earthen enclosure, is ecologically sound and economically sensible. In time and scale, it also served well populous China and South Asia. Most countries in Southeast Asia and certain areas in Central Asia and Eastern Europe, when the rapidly growing population had to be supplied with protein food. Through time, farmers of this system preserved its best feature, farming within the limits of nature. It supplied the world with enough cultured fish for a time. But demand was increasing from a rapidly rising population. Seeing the need to build aquaculture into a full-fledged industry, FAO organized in 1976 the first global conference on aquaculture. The event marked the transition of fish farming from a traditional to a modern practice. The first turning point was the Kyoto Declaration on Aquaculture, promoted through technical cooperation among developing countries and facilitated by intergovernmental networking mechanisms in Asia and the Pacific, followed eventually by new regional networks of governments, institutions, producers, and experts in Europe, North America, Africa, and the Americas. The Kyoto Declaration placed aquaculture prominently in national planning. It became recognized as a legitimate user of land and water resources and worthy of more research investment. Personnel were trained for better planning, management, research, and production. The technological component of the declaration boosted productivity. Farmed areas expanded, harvests became more reliable, and aquaculture soon emerged as the fastest growing food production sector. aquaculture is now poised to overtake capture fisheries as a supplier of food fish. From 3 million tons a year in the 1970s, production in 2009 had exceeded 50 million tons. But with 78 million more people every year and the slim growth prospect of capture fishery, aquaculture will need to do more. In the next two decades, fish farmers will have to supply 28 million tons more than they are producing now to maintain the current per capita supply of 17 kilograms of fish a year. One of two food fish consumed in the world is farmed. Farmed or wild, fish is good for the health. One-sixth of humanity derive one-fourth of their animal protein from fish, giving them a wealth of health benefits. As to jobs, now getting harder to find, aquaculture creates many opportunities. A broad estimate places employment in aquaculture at some 30 million full-time equivalent workers, about 21 million direct, and nearly 9 million indirect jobs. Commercial and industrial scale operations and an increasingly efficient global trade regime and marketing network have vastly improved the supply and quality of farmed fish. These have also brought down the price of fish in real terms. Nevertheless, the major responsibility of supplying fish to rural communities still falls on farmers, who have been variously described as small scale, with poor access to resources, and some non-commercial. These descriptions apply to many fish farmers in Asia, Africa, Latin America, and the Caribbean. An important group are those that farm with a low level of technology and inputs. They have lower yield levels, but have shown remarkable resilience against economic and natural shocks. Livelihood restoration for 200 families that suffered from a severe prolonged flood included catfish farming in small ponds. Catfish was the only available protein food after the flood. The sector has been reasonably successful. It is the only food production industry whose growth rate over the past 30 years has remained ahead of population growth. To feed a growing world, it has had to push beyond the constraints imposed by nature, at times disorderly and with little restraint. In the late 1980s, it began to show this tendency, subsequently suffering from its unfortunate effects that included pollution, disease, and social disapproval. To bring order to the development of fisheries and aquaculture, FAO and its member governments in 1995 promulgated the Code of Conduct for Responsible Fisheries. Enshrined in the code are the principles of environmental and social responsibility. The code marks the second turning point for aquaculture. Those who wanted to farm in accord with the principles were assisted with technical guides and standards and certification schemes, ensuring social and environmental responsibility that made the sector busy. Water from a common source is shared with crop farmers. We fill the farm's water reservoir only once a year. Effluent water is treated and recycled, thus preventing pollution of public waters. Going into the third millennium, the sector saw the need to meld and translate into a working strategy the principles that farmers earn a fair reward from farming, benefits and costs are equitably shared, society benefits from fish farming without being harmed by its practice or products, wealth and more jobs are created, enough food is accessible to all, the environment is conserved for the next generation, and aquaculture development is sustainable. At the Conference on Aquaculture in the Third Millennium, these principles were unified into a global strategy to achieve the social, economic, and environmental sustainability goals of aquaculture development. The Bangkok Declaration and Strategy for Aquaculture Development Beyond 2000 is the third turning point. Immediately after the conference, the governments mandated FAO to create the Sub-Committee on Aquaculture, the fourth turning point. four major turning points, or watersheds, over 25 years. Enough to propel or nourish aquaculture development through the next 25. And so it would have been, but for a new menace that came to serious note hardly 5 years into this millennium. Global warming. Along with a colossal task and great cost to mitigate its cause and manage its impacts, global warming also presents opportunities. This would call for innovative actions, developing creative and efficient ways to adapt and cope, more efficient use of tools we now have to continue on a sustainable path without sacrificing growth, and turning problems into opportunities. But there remain hurdles. Fish farming will have to play a part in reducing greenhouse gases. For instance, better management practices increase energy efficiency and optimize the use of farm resources. Integrated systems and farming filter feeders and seaweeds have near zero carbon footprint. Seafood consumers would pay more for products from the traditional horizontally integrated aquaculture systems. Emerging systems such as integrated multi-trophic aquaculture, better technologies that allow cost-efficient offshore farming in cages, also serve the objectives of resilience and adaptation to climate change. Governance frameworks, such as the ecosystem approach to fisheries and aquaculture in risk analysis, offer better ways to address complex fisheries and aquaculture management issues. Along with these, the sector will have to sharpen its competitiveness in an increasingly sophisticated and a modernizing global market. The bright view is that aquaculture will continue to grow, an optimism founded on its performance and dynamism in the last 30 years. Aquaculture is not new to facing these challenges. It has the tools, forged in the Kyoto Declaration, sharpened by the adoption of the Code of Conduct for Responsible Fisheries, wielded with increasing confidence by the application of the Bangkok Declaration and Strategy, and thrust forward with resolute government commitments through the Sub-Committee on Aquaculture.
We have seen food aquaculture expanding into business aquaculture. A lot of new technologies that open new opportunities for that business aquaculture sector. However, we have huge challenges ahead of us. We will have to join forces, east and west, south and north, and go for a more holistic approach involving the different stakeholders.
The tools have worked with varying degrees of effectiveness against hunger and malnutrition, rural poverty, pollution, and disease. Amidst diminishing land and fresh water resources, a rising demand for more and safer food, and through energy and financial crises. We will need to make them sharper, more effective, and more versatile yet, in a warming earth, so that aquaculture can serve the people better, and communities and nations continue to prosper in peace and harmony.